Emily Dickinson. Tell all the truth, but tell it at a slant. Success in circuit lies too bright for our infirm delight. The true superb surprise, as lightning to the children eased with explanation kind. The truth must dazzle gradually, or every man be blind. And it came to pass. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And Joseph also went up from Galilee into the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she would be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room at the inn.
The story this morning, The Emperor's Tea, was written by Harold Stewart, and I found it in Carl Seberg's Unitarian Universalist anthology titled Celebrating Christmas. It's one of those stories that I discovered during divinity school and I go back to every few years. It seems endlessly relevant to me somehow, perhaps because it offers so many different insights about unwrapping the Christmas holidays. And so this year, as I read the story, I asked myself, what if we thought about the emperor's tea as the truth, in quotes, at the very heart of the Christmas holiday, the deep meaning, the real gift? And what if we understood the mulberry leaf tea, the mistaken use of the packing material, as the gift? What if we understood that as a mistaken understanding of the holiday? And what if the ebony box and the silk wrapping and the lacquered box are all of the beautiful and sophisticated cultural forms inspired by the gift at the heart of this season? What if they represent all of the great art that has accrued around the kernel of this holiday? And what if we think about the rice paper and the red ribbon as the customs and traditions, you know, the Christmas cookies and the decorated trees and the caroling? And what if the stamps were to signify the economic and commercial monetary face of the holiday, the money we spend on gifts and on people who are far away? Do you notice that in the story, each person seizes on the aspect of the gift that most speaks to him or to her? That happens to us too. Confronted by the complex territory of this Christmas season, we gravitate, each of us, to different elements of the wrapping. Many of us love the purely secular and often expensive gift exchanges and feasting, the communal nature of the thing, the reanimating of our ties to people far away. Others are fed more deeply by the many traditions that comprise the holiday activities, the carols and the cookies, the trees, the midnight service, the food drives, the charitable giving. Some are inspired by great works of art. Handel's Messiah, the Ode to Joy, the thousand paintings of the Madonna and Child. And every one of these gifts, every piece of the wrapping, is an authentic gift in and of itself, an inspired response to the giving of the first gift, the innermost gift in the package, the emperor's tea. The first gift in our case would be the gift given in that nativity story. Now, did you notice in the story of the emperor's tea that everyone at the party is disappointed when they taste the tea made out of the mulberry leaves? They're all polite, they all ask for more, but they all feel betrayed somehow. And do you notice how all of the other beautiful gifts are diminished if that first gift, that emperor's tea, is a sham. If somehow, rather than being precious and nourishing, it's bland or toxic. I think that's what happens to lots and lots of Unitarian Universalists at Christmas time. Somehow, we end up with mulberry leaf tea, and as a result, the whole holiday is tarnished and somehow drained of a deeper meaning. What if we were, this morning at least, to understand the mulberry leaf tea as the literal interpretation of that Christmas narrative? What if, when we try to read that narrative with our customary rationalist, historic, scientific Enlightenment lens, we have mistaken the packing material, the historical events that cushion and contain the real gift, for the gift itself? Now, it doesn't happen to me very often as a Unitarian Universalist minister that I attend a party where somebody offers me a cup of mulberry leaf tea, a literal interpretation of the life of Jesus. But it has happened a couple of times, most memorably when Isaac and Zoe were in preschool at a church from another denomination. That's when I realized that even one sip of biblical literalism gives me a stomachache. With a literal reading of the Christmas story, we have two choices, I think. We can suppress our reason and accept that story as true and meaningful and relevant, even in the face of our perhaps rather visceral experience that something is wrong and the mulberry leaf tea is not so good. Or we can admit that the tea is awful and the wrappings are just so much empty hype, and we can discard the whole enterprise, discard the box of mulberry leaves, without ever finding the tea, the real gift, which is buried inside. And what of all of those other gifts that surround and elevate the first one? What of the silk and the lacquered box, the great art, the beautiful traditions? What if the creators of those gifts know something that we do not? That the mulberry leaves are not the tea? What if the story was never meant to be taken literally? What if packed inside the mulberry leaves there is another box and it has the real tea, the real meaning of this holiday? As Unitarian Universalists, we find that meaning, the emperor's tea, in a non-literal, symbolic, spiritual, and poetic reading of that text. And what we need to remember is that where art and metaphor and meaning-making are concerned, a non-literal telling can be every bit as true as a recitation of the facts. Biblical scholar and member of the Jesus Seminar, Marcus Borg, writes, "Myths can be both true and powerful, even though they are symbolic narratives and not straightforward historical reports. Although they are not literally true, they can be really true. Though not factually true, they can be actually true." The Nativity narrative is a myth with a capital M. It's clear. It was never intended to be factual as our 21st century minds understand that. At the time that Jesus lived, and at the time his life and death became important enough that people wanted to recount the story of his birth, our Enlightenment, rationalist, historical, scientific perspective didn't exist yet. What was important in the ancient world, both in Greek and in Jewish thinking and in their storytelling, was that a great man's birth should foretell the importance of his life. And so when they crafted the nativity narrative years after Jesus' death, The authors of that narrative used all of the literary devices, all of the tropes available to communicate the birth of a great man or a god. A virgin birth, stars, wise men, animals, these aren't unique to the nativity story of Jesus. They were common story forms that communicated to the listener the importance and specialness of the child. But if we're not supposed to approach the story as history, how are we to read it then? Well, we need to approach it in the same way we would approach the statement, George W. Bush was born with a silver spoon in his mouth. Now that's a true statement, yes? Of course. But is it literally accurate? Of course not. In the case of virtually all religious narratives, the meaning doesn't reside in the story's accuracy as a factual document. It resides in the story itself as a literary and religious artifact, which tells us something important about humankind and about the world. Now, the persistence of the particular story we're talking about today, the persistence of the story is the first evidence that there's a truth hidden somewhere on the inside. The presence of all of those inspired wrappings that surround the story further support the idea. This story has been told for more than 2,000 years. It's inspired great art and deep tradition and generosity. There is indeed a truth within it, but to find it, we're going to have to dig through our literal assumptions. We have to sift through the mulberry leaves and find the poetic meaning within. But there's more. You see, even when someone hands you the ivory box that contains the emperor's tea, even when someone shares with you the insight that the holiday is not to be read literally but non-literally, you still have to boil the water. You have to rinse the teapot and brew the tea. You have to pour the tea and feel the heat of the cup and smell the steam and drink it or not. You have to do the work of making your meaning out of the text. It's right there in front of you, but you have to make the tea. If you're willing to do that, if you're willing to sit down for the space of a cup of tea and ask yourself, well, what if this were a story that were true on the inside? What if it were like the emperor's tea? What truths might you find? Well, one of the things about poetry and symbolic language, about myth and story, is that they are meaning dense. They fold many different interpretations into a small space. They are compact. And this is certainly true of that nativity story. I don't know when you sit down with the text, if you sit down with the text. I don't know which meaning will be most important to you this year. Different meanings present themselves in different seasons of our lives. Some years, the most resonant message for me is the message of the incarnation, the message that humankind, and therefore all of creation, is the body of God, and therefore holy and precious. Some years I resonate most with the poverty and the lowliness of the setting and the call to distributive justice suggested by God's choice to be born poor and by the riches given to that poor child. Some years I find the most resonant truth in the message of the angels to the shepherds, "Be not afraid, we bring you tidings of great joy. Peace on earth, goodwill to all." Everything is holy. Everyone deserves enough. Peace is the path. There are other meanings in the story as well, but in any given year, any one of the three I've just mentioned is sufficient for me. Any one of them can give real depth and luster to all the other wrappings of the holiday. So, Go shopping. Wrap presents. Mail them to the people you love. Bake cookies, host parties, light Advent candles and Yule logs. Set up a creche if you have one. Go caroling. Listen to Handel's Messiah. Holding in mind always the awareness that the mulberry leaves of biblical literalism are not the mythic truth. They are not the emperor's tea. Knowing that, you can enter the holiday without drinking that tea. I would invite you, though, sometime soon, maybe tonight when the snow starts flying again, or maybe tomorrow, I would invite you to make yourself a cup of tea and then sit down with the biblical text of the Nativity story. If you have one, you can open your Bible, but you can find it in any number of children's illustrated gift books, or even more mundane, you can go online and Google it. But find the text somewhere and sit down and read it, looking for some truth on the inside that might speak to you this year, and knowing that the emperor's tea lies within.